and welcome to the 3DNDocs 14 SCP2 bootcamp sessions. In this session, we will focus on the content manager, and in particular, we will talk about the platform support, the active-inactive flag, the remove of collaborative review, translation organizer, the taxonomy connector for 3DN sites, how to set it up, and we will end with the dynamic experience delivery. The content manager platform support. But first, another topic I would love to address is that actually, if you're coming from the knowledge center, then you probably already know that it becomes 3DN, STL 3DN docs, and this is already done in the 13 SP1 release. For the rebranding, we didn't rebrand everything, so we, on the technical side, we leave it as it is, so we still have the code name InfoShare all over the place, and that is not going to change. For the new release, we added collective spaces URL, so that is for the default is called isCS for collective spaces. For the client installation path, we actually switched from 32-bit to 64-bit, so instead of C program files x86, it now becomes C program files. And for the XML editor menu, we changed from live content to knowledge center, and now this is actually STL 3DN docs. Sort platform support, and what we retire and what's supported. So the STL TriSoft 2011 R2, the STL live content 2013, STL live content 2014, they're all retired. STL Knowledge Center 2016, that has limited support currently, that will end in July this year. The STL 3DN docs 13, that will end, or limited support ends at July 2021, so that's next year. And the 3DN docs 14, that is fully supported. Also good to know is that Exopus is extended support, so the content editor and collaborative review extended support ends in February 2021. That's a side note. For the platform and integration, so we, in the 14 SP2 release, we introduced document history in BarSpace, and we do some extra new stuff, maturity on the draft space and review space, we improved it in this 14 SP2 release. We deprecated the translation extension, also UDC and commenting dashboard that also becomes deprecated. And what is obsolete now is the quality assistant, content editor, collaborative review, legacy delivery, and also pre-translation. That one is also becoming obsolete in this release. Some naming that we had in the past as well. So we started live content that become later knowledge center, and then we're merging 3DN sites and 3DN docs, and then in the end it become 3DN DX. So this basically, the left side is the legacy pack and also the component names. And we more or less will focus now on 3DN docs content manager and the 3DN docs dynamic experience. The quality assistant and the content editor, they are obsolete, and the same actually is for the 3DN docs collaborative review, and the draft space and review space, we put it under the umbrella of collective spaces. And also still note that pre-translation is also deprecated. So what is in the box? So if you get it, the CD layout, what we actually does not contain anymore is something like the content editor. And if you will run the isDeploy commands like enable is content editor or isUI quality assistant, it will fail because it's not part of the product anymore. So quality assistant is also not part of the CD anymore. The same for the legacy content delivery and also for the collaborative review. What is also good to know functionality-wise and API, it's actually highlighted the most important one, that is batch import, that is replaced by a content importer, and also removed some API 2.0 endpoints. And again, like deprecated, is the pre-translations, but also the ASMX web services. For Windows Server, so what we currently support is Windows Server 2019. It's, you can run it as a core or the desktop experience version, but we don't support the Nano one for Windows 2019. Also, Windows 2016 is important, and what is currently not supported anymore, that is the Windows 2011 R2 64-bit version. On the .NET framework, we added support for 4.8 for the .NET full framework that's done in 14 SP1. In 14 release, we already added support for 4.7.2, and what we no longer support is 4.6.2 in this release. For SQL Server, we added support for SQL Server 2019. This is done in the 14 SP2 release. It has the same performance as the SQL Server 2017. And 2017, as well as SQL Server 2016 SP2 is deprecated in this version. And also in this new release, the only thing we actually changed is an index. We extended that one with a hostname. Also, maybe good to know, SQL Server 2019, they introduced a performance improvement for scalar valued user defined functions, and that has actually some impact on our user defined functions. We removed a couple of them and also changed a couple of them for the SQL Server 2019 to be able to run successfully. So we run a full integration test on it and everything is working correctly. If you still experience issues, there are some commands or database settings, you can actually turn off this new performance improvement for the scalar valued user defined functions. So then after that one, it is definitely working again correctly. For Oracle database, we supported Oracle 19c, and what is deprecated is the Oracle 12c and Oracle 12.2, and we don't support anymore Oracle 18c. Again, also, the only thing we did in this 14 SP2 is changing an index and extended basically the same index also with the hostname. It is also good to know that the .NET code is switched to .NET standard, and that allows us actually to use the Oracle managed data access core NuGet package. So it's also part of the issue of the CD layout. And the .NET code no longer needs the installation of the local Oracle client. But of course, our VB6 code still needs the 32-bit Oracle client. You also now have the option to have a limited Oracle 19 client installation. So you only need to install the already components, the TNS.ORA, and also basically a third-party installer. For the translation systems, we currently support STL TMS, the whole 12 version, and what is deprecated is the whole 12 version of TMS. And for World Server, we support the full range of the 12 version or the 11 version. For Java, so currently we support Java, and the versions we support are the OpenJDK 11 and also the Oracle Java 11. And what we don't support anymore are Java 8, 9, and 10. And the Java Open ADK 11 is verified also with our Solar Jetty in the Dita Open Toolkit. So it's working accordingly or the same as Oracle Java 11. For the browser support, so we support Microsoft Edge and also Edge Chromium. We support Google Chrome, Firefox, but all of them are the one we support are actually the latest release in the update channel of the browsers. So what we don't support anymore are the Microsoft Internet Explorer 10 and 11. Just a high level overview on the collected spaces, the 13 docs, 14 SP2. So actually what we added in this release are the Fontel Delta XML and the Fontel document history. And the document history was explained in another session on this bootcamp. So please have a look at that one if you want to know more about document history. And also, like before, we also added the Fontel Review Service as well. So there are basically three new services compared to the 13 release. A little bit about the flow for collected spaces regarding the document history. So if you basically in your draw space and you want to list the document history of a particular topic, you just make a call basically to our Fontel document history service, and it will actually get all the documents to show the whole list of the history. But if you want to see all the delta with it, it actually loops through all the particular versions and get basically the delta of it. So it's really a nice overview of what has changed in the whole history. And that after the loop of all the deltas, collecting all the deltas is done, then it actually returns to the browser, and then you can see the nice overview of it. A little bit about the find and replace. So for the find and replace, basically we're also using the solo routine for the get and first good impression what is actually find. And then after that, where we find it, we will actually also when the collected space bin do the find and replace, we find it, all this stuff, basically solve the scene for a faster response, and then go to the UI, and then the people can actually go through all the steps, and then we're using Fontel to calculate the right positions in the documents, and then it's actually highlighted, and with the replace, you can actually replace the content one by one. If you want to know more about the find and replace functionality on collective spaces, please look at the section on overview on the collective spaces, the functional overview. As you probably already saw as well, the functionality of hosting Java processes is changed a little bit in this version, the 14 SP2. That's also due to that we want to get rid of dependencies as well, runtime dependencies in our product. So what we also did release is removing the C++ runtime dependency. So before, when we actually host a Java service, we using the Java bind, and that is actually as a link to the C++ runtime. So what we did in the 14 SP2 release, we actually created basically our own launcher. So we have an own utility, and that actually will launch a Jetty or a Java process that hosts a Jetty web service, and in that web server, we actually host the WAR of that particular application. And we did that for the solo scene, but also for the Fontel Delta XML one. So the TriSoft will, Jetta launcher will actually initialize, and also if you stop the service, it also makes sure that it shuts down that new process. It's like a separate process as well. And we also have an RP check, so we keep monitoring if the service is still alive. It's also good to know for the install plan, so many requisite keys for the solo scene are now moved to the Jetty launcher as well. As you also see, so the Jetty web service, also the version changed. I see there's a small mistake in the version, but the Jetty web service upgrade from 9 to 9.4.26. And this one is actually required, so we have control over the maximum memory used by the Java process. We all know that Java loves memory, but sometimes if you want to demo it on a small instance or small machine, you have more control over the maximum memory used for this Java process. if you need more, you can also change the setting as well. The active inactive flag. So active inactive flag is being introduced for obsolete value. So a lot of what you see during your implementation over time, that sometimes you add configuration values or a list of values that are there, but they don't make sense currently anymore, but they're still valid for old situations. So what we actually achieved is that we can specify some values, make them active, inactive. If they're not inactive, you won't see them in our UI, basically. And that gives you more control over it, what the user can select as well, what we don't do any validation on it. So we won't break functionality. So it's actually the implemented active inactive flag support for the user interfaces. So like I said, there's no check and force server side if the value is inactive, yes or no. It can be configured, those ones, where the web client and the NF remote. And also there are a couple of methods extended in the baseline API that did not support it yet. So retrieve metadata too. And the find also currently respect the active inactive flag. So the active inactive flag is actually limit the number of entries in a selected list. And currently we're looking at the list of values, user group, user roles, the baseline output formats, and electronic document type. This can be all configured in a metadata config XML. And also for the scope, it's respected or visible on the web client. It's actually only ASP.NET only. So the classic ASP pages that we currently have, they're not in scope. So the folder properties won't respect them. But also what collect spaces, also the client tools, they are aware of this active inactive flag. There are also some schema changes as well in order to make it work for the metadata config. So the schema has been extended to allow the activity filter attribute, and the values that you can actually set are none, active, or inactive. So with active, then only active entries will be available, and inactive only then the inactive field available, and then of course, like I said, so all of them, all the entries will be shown. We make some changes to the out of the box metadata config XML. So the activity filter set to active for all selected lists for fields used in the property forms for the let's say for the client tools and also for the web client as well. There's still a couple of non-metadata config XML based lists. So for example, for the client tools, for the account properties, what you can see in the language, they are only shown the active values, and the same applies actually for the images resolutions as well. So you cannot configure it, but it will only limit it to the active values. Another one for the non-metadata config XML based list is actually selecting the output format. So only the output formats that are currently active are shown. So if you want to create a new output format or new output, then actually it only displays the list that with active values. Remove of a collaborative review. So this was actually the overview what we had in the 13 SP1 release. And what we did in the 14 release, we actually get rid of content editor Exopus. So it's no longer available in the content manager or in Reach or collaborative review. And also, like I said, so in the end, we also removed the legacy content delivery and also collaborative review. What we currently also is deprecated is actually the UDC, so also the UDC backend, the UDC database and the UDC moderation backend. So the whole concept of UDC is currently deprecated. But does it mean on the web client? So on the web client, on the slide out navigation, the collaborative review menu option is removed. In the web client, collaborative review URI is also removed, and the utility tool, or the database utility tool, will remove the value of it. So after the upgrade, that one is no longer there. And since there's no collaborative review in the database anymore, so comments are no longer shown in the publication manager. Collaborative review output formats, which have a style processor content delivery, are now marked as inactive. And active, inactive, if you create a new publication, output only the active one is shown. So this one is not shown anymore in your list. For the collaborative review comments, so there's no out-of-the-box migration to annotation. So annotation was shown in a different session in this recording of the bootcamp. So if you want to know more about annotations, please have a look at the functional overview of collective spaces. There still can be custom migration done by using the collaborative review and the review, the annotation API. But it is a custom migration, it's not that we do that out of the box. Translation organizer. For translation organizer, we actually introduced a unique identifier that will actually help us finding the particular translation job if something goes wrong. We've seen in the past that sometimes the creating a translation jobs on the remote system fails, or it's there but we don't get a good response from it, and then we are no longer able to find it, and then sometimes you double the projects on the remote system. That also probably will duplicate the cost as well, and that's something we don't want. So now we actually have a special format. So with the translation job name, we also have the creator. They have a unique identifier then of the translation job. And then, of course, we also have a batch number if it's done in batches, this whole translation job. For the translation organizer TMS authentication. So TMS changed their authentication type. So currently, they support the API secret, as highlighted as the authentication mode. But also in the docs 14, we added support for the user credentials authentication mode. It's built actually on top of the CTA library, and we changed the CTA library as well from version 11 to version 12.4.7 in 14 SP2. You don't have to go into the files themselves in order to change the application mode with the API key or secret. You can also use the isdeploy commandlet, so set is integration TMS, and that has now support for using the API secret or the credential. Setting the credential, so both are there currently supported. So we will advise you to use the isdeploy commandlet to make the correct changes to the TMS authentication. For the translation organizer, we made an improvement in the search spec one. So before there were actually no checks when you deleted in translation job. So that has the a side effect that any user can delete a busy translation job, which is linked actually to an unfinished job in World Server. So our translation job is finished, but but the other one in build serve is not finished. So when it was finished, it was not possible to import them in our 3D docs repository. So what we have done is add an exit check of forcing the users first to cancel the translation job, so it's also cancelled on the remote system. And when that is done, you can actually delete it. We still allow administrators to delete any translation job, so in case something really went wrong or you cannot really connect to the remote system anymore, still the administrations can delete the translation job. So the translation can only be deleted if the translation job is in the cancelled, completed with warnings, export completed or export completed with warnings. Otherwise, the translation job first needs to be cancelled, allowing the unfinished job and build server or TMS to be cancelled as well. Then we go to the taxonomy connector for 3D Insights. This has to do with the content message story for 3D docs and 3D Insights. For 3D on 3D Insights, basically all the items in there have a specific TCM ID, and TCM IDs are unique across an instance. It is really unique in the instance itself, but it does not survive DTAP flows. So if you export it using content ported to export your content and import it in another database, those IDs can change or will change. They probably won't be the same, or you have to be very lucky. So that was actually our first attempt, what we did with the taxonomy connector for 3D Insights. So we come up basically with a couple of options to improve it. So we can also use like for a web dev URL. So that will, it's safe, of course, DTAP, but it's unsafe when you restructure your keywords or categories, then the web dev URL will change. So we still have the options of the IDs, the TCM IDs, that won't survive DTAP strategies, but are safe to restructuring the keywords in categories. But there is also another options on the keywords. That's actually each keyword has a key. That key is unique in a blueprint. And it's also safe across a DTAP environment, and it's also safe in restructuring your keyword and categories. So that is actually why we come up with a new version of the Sites taxonomy connector, and now actually we're using the key of the keyword to store in docs. So this is actually how we also are able to do the whole linking as well between sites and docs using the same taxonomy. So the key is now used as an identifier for the selected keyword. And also a web dev URL, we also allow that one to be configured in the configuration for the category, so it's the root of your taxonomy. There's also a new connector as a hotfix available for the 13 release as well. So like I said, for the web dev, so for the category ID, so that's basically the root of your taxonomy. We also have support now for the web dev as well. So that also will survive DTAP refinements as well. So still want to have a remark about the keys of a keyword. So if a keyword does not have a key, it is not selectable in 3D docs. So it can be seen as a navigation keyword, but you cannot select it. Also, we don't have any automatic conversion. So if you're already using the old taxonomy connector and now use the new one, there's no automatic conversion to use to start using the keys instead of the TCM URIs. We will know if it's a TCM URI or a key, and if it's a TCM URI, we actually put a asterisk behind the name, and then you meaning we have to first remove it and then add it again as a particular keyword. Then it becomes more stable. What we also did is the new site taxonomy connector is now actually .NET standard instead of using the full framework. And also we make it a little bit easier to configure the endpoint URL of the taxonomy connector. So we have the short URL only as the host name, but still if you come from old version and install the new taxonomy connector, you can leave the endpoint address as is because we only take the host name of the URL. And still a reminder, so the minimum SDL treated site version that is supported in this scenario is 9.0. The web application server setup. So for the empty and demo databases, so the empty and the demo database are upgraded to 14SP1. It also is the latest out-of-the-box configuration files that are submitted, including also the Theta and Monitoring editor templates. But after you actually restore the database, you always need to run the DB upgrade tool to ensure that all the database jobs are created, the latest database upscripts are executed, and also the statistics for the indexes are generated as well. Some remark on the configuration quick start settings file. Here you actually see all the changes, what changed between the version 13 and the 14SP2. It's basically the same as the what we did for the 14 release and what we extra added in the 14SP2 that's at the bottom for the XML collected spaces configuration. It now also holds the review space statuses to be reviewed. That's the only thing we did in the 14SP2 release. The dynamic experience delivery. This is about the architecture, so how it's going to look like. So we have a deployer that has extensions, and the extensions are there for connecting sites to the deployer, but also docs for the deployer. So they have all their own extension. They publish to the same DXD environment, so to the same deployer, and the content is then stored in the broker. And on top of the broker, we have the interactive services, and that can also be like extensions there as well. And then we also have now a nice endpoint, so it's a GraphQL-based public content API. And this web application, like DXA2.2 has a GraphQL client that will talk to the GraphQL API on the interactive service to retrieve all the information. And that information can be for trading docs and trading sites. And you also now are able to find related items as well. So that's why we have the Tree Insights taxonomy connector. So you can classify content using the same keyword in both sites and docs. And that one you can also find easy related content. So from your marketing material, if you classify it, your components, you can also find the related topics as well and display that on the same page. Just a reminder, so what has changed in DXD 11.1? So we had actually unpublished Trinium Talks publications. So now also the content is removed from the database and also the Elasticsearch index. There's a new GraphQL public content API, so it's available at the API on the interactive surface. And also the search is improved, so a better granularity on Chinese, Japanese, and Korean languages. And basically, we host two repositories and one environment for treating docs and treating sites. You can actually query them separately on the GraphQL endpoint. Some on the platform support for DXD, so it will support the operating systems Windows Server 2016 and 2019. And if you want to run it on Linux, we support Linux Red Hat Enterprise 7.6 and 8. For the .NET framework, 4.8 is supported, and for Java, we support both Oracle JDK 11 and Adobe OpenJDK 11. For the databases, we have SQL Server Azure, RDS 2017, Oracle 83 and 93. And for the experience optimization and treating doc search, we have Elasticsearch 6.7 and also support for Chinese, Japanese, and Korean languages. We have a couple of DXD and DXA versions. So compared to the 14.SP1 release, 14.SP2, there are no changes there as well. So we prefer that you run on DXD version 1.2. And for DXA, both versions are actually supported. So 2.1 and 2.2. So if you're coming from an old version, from DDWebApp1.x, please upgrade to DXA 2.2 with the dynamic documentation module. So this brings it at the end of this session. Please watch all the recordings of the other sessions as well. Thank you.